It's a real pleasure to be here at the National Research Foundation and, of course, to be in Pretoria, to be in South Africa. So I'm delighted to be able to speak to you, and I want to speak to you about a subject which should make us happy and sad at the same time. The way in which science has flourished, which is quite extraordinary, and the challenges science faces, which are significant. The extent to which the advancement of science has brought quality without bringing equality, and the extent to which we should be asking more of science in several regards. There's also the importance of PowerPoint training for all scientists. As already indicated, I'll speak about the value and the values of science, the importance of science, but what we should care about in science. First, I want to thank, though, the hosts. Thank you, Lapo. Thank you, Crane. Thank you, Beverly. And everyone here who makes the visit possible. And I'm going to begin with a small editorial. I don't presume to speak about the situation in South Africa in detail. I don't know it. I don't have the ability to say, oh, this is the right policy, or if only this would change in South Africa, things would be better, or so forth. You all know more about South Africa than I do. But I care about South Africa. I care for some of the same reasons of caring about the people who are the potential beneficiaries of science in South Africa. Caring about institutional structures, including the relationship of science to the various institutions, including universities, where science is pursued, and the very interesting questions, how that will evolve in the future. But I also care about South Africa as an outsider, because it faces distinctive, sometimes extreme versions of problems that are faced around the world. I suspect that it sometimes seems like these are all very much South African problems, and they are, as though it's entirely because of the history of South Africa, the history of apartheid, the history of the struggle, entirely because of the situation of South Africa that these problems appear in South Africa, whether it's the problems about universities that are signaled by student movements to abolish fees, or there are the problems of access, the problems of language, the problems of the extent to which pursuing research excellence demands resources, and there are other calls for those resources in other areas, including other parts of higher education and education at large. These are pressing issues for South Africa, I know, but they are issues in which South Africa faces a variant of issues around the world. Countries like the United States, where I live and work, or Britain, where I spent much of my career, also face versions of these problems. They have cushions, sometimes of financial resources not available in South Africa. They have cushions of some historical investments in institutions that are not available to all institutions. But the larger pressures, challenges, and potentials are in many ways shared. So South Africa is special and distinctive within a larger set of global issues. Just as China is special and distinctive and has a history, and it is producing different kinds of responses to some of the same questions. But enough of that. Science is basic to modern society. I trust that nobody who shows up at a lecture at the National Research Foundation doubts that. But I really mean basic in the sense that modern society can only exist in part on the basis of science. That science, right, is an underpinning. Just like we talk about infrastructure, we say modern society needs roads and bridges and electrical grid, right? Science is part of the infrastructure, the mental consciousness, knowledge infrastructure of modern society. And we should celebrate what science has done in that. But we should not let that make us complacent. We have to look at the challenges that are being faced. And we have to look at questions about whether we are doing enough to face them, and in particular, whether we can face them without new and and sometimes stronger and different structures of collaboration. We need each other, collaboration within the sciences. The NRF already embodies within its structure an embrace of arts and humanities and social sciences, as well as natural sciences and physical sciences, which is part of that collaboration that is required. But as I'll say more, we have underdeveloped that. We have overdeveloped the image of the brilliant individual, and we have underdeveloped some of the structures of collaboration we need. Why do we need them? Why do we care? We need trustworthy knowledge. This is part of what science gives to modern society. It would be a mistake to start by saying, oh, science gives us cures for diseases and science gives us technology. That's true. But those are products of trustworthy knowledge. Science in general produces trustworthy knowledge. The scientific method is for this, right? And I won't make this a lecture on the scientific method, but remember that the scientific method, whether it's organized in experiments or in other research techniques, is about being able to learn new things and test what you think you've learned. The testing part of the scientific method is crucial. It depends, among other things, on publication and on a larger scientific environment in which other scientists will test what the first scientist said. So the scientific method is a method not just of finding things out, but of testing our knowledge and ensuring that it is trustworthy. This then makes it a basis for government policy, or a basis for industrial use in developing new products, or a basis for technologies and those medical cures. Science, right, also though exemplifies something about modernity. In addition to being a basis for society in this sense, it exemplifies an attitude that is important in modernity, a willingness to learn continuously. And I would suggest that is especially important now, because we are in a period of dramatic change. Again, I don't have to repeat this or elaborate on it in South Africa, which has been in a period of dramatic change for a while, right? There is a continual demand for knowledge to evolve, not to say we just know. Everything that professors learned when they were undergraduates is enough to teach the undergraduates today. It's not. The continued movement of science is crucial. And science, because it produces trustworthy knowledge, is basic to addressing social problems. Often, right, that connection is weak. I think the engagement that is being pursued by NRF is part of an effort to make it stronger, to make sure that science contributes in all the ways that it can. And problems here doesn't just mean things that are bad. It means things that are difficult to understand, which can involve the creation of a new technology, the bottleneck in being able to deploy a new technology. Right? What are the bottlenecks in deploying a variety of new surgical techniques that depend in part on coupling artificial intelligence and new kinds of vision systems with the tradition of surgery in order to do microsurgery, right? That's a problem, right? It will result in good things. It's not just bad things, but it's an intellectual problem to be solved. Science is crucial to this, but science is sometimes its own enemy here. Scientific specialization sometimes gets in the way of interdisciplinary collaboration, but it's important to be able to do that. Think of the example I just sketched in very abstract terms, which involves medical doctors working with experts in artificial intelligence and experts in visualization. Represented visualization. First off, there's the issue that medical doctors usually don't like to think that anybody else is deploying crucial technology. They do, right? But secondly, these are people from different fields with different ideas of how things work, right? And the importance of the collaboration is bringing them together. There's more. That particular cluster of science and technology depends on an industry-academic collaboration, because it's being pursued by companies that make medical technology and other parts of this, including artificial intelligence. The AI work in that particular case isn't just from university researchers, it's from corporate researchers, being coupled with physicians at hospitals, which may be academic teaching hospitals, may be organized in other ways. Collaboration is crucial. Advancing the public good is the outcome. Whether we solve transportation problems with one kind of science, or develop new medical procedures with another kind of science, or make democracy work better, is still a third kind of science. The public good ought to be the goal. This is the basis for public funding. Now, sometimes we actually misrepresent ourselves. We act as though we think the basis for public funding is how smart we are. Or we think the basis for public funding is that we did so well in our studies or our publications, we present our curricula vitae, and we say, look, I have published in all the leading journals, support me. But the reason the public supports is to advance the public good. And if science wants to be a part of advancing the public good, it has to be clear about this. And it has to be clear about the reasons. So we, especially academic scientists, need to be sure that we're clear that we want to make contributions to the public good. Now, that doesn't mean abandoning science, far from it. And it doesn't mean abandoning basic science, which is crucial to this, in order to do only applied science. But it means recognizing a sense of obligation to that cause, not to public opinion of the moment, which may say things that are completely contrary to science, but to advancing the public good. We should celebrate, recognize the achievements, recognize that science has long roots, recognize that books are still important, libraries are still important. You just heard from Ismail Saragaldin, the longtime librarian, the founding librarian of the revived Alexandria Library, an extraordinary institution, but also somebody who speaks to the fact that knowledge, that goal of trustworthy knowledge in the public good, which I cited, depends on good curation of existing knowledge. It depends on having all those books, and now they're often computerized to make them accessible, to store them better and keep them safer, right? Having all those books and articles and other past science, making it accessible, having search engines and other tools that enable us to get it, making it shared globally, right, so that JSTOR and other things are affordable in other parts of the world besides where they're developed, right? But curating it in the sense of continually keeping track of what is known in various fields so that it's part of the resource for continued scientific research. We don't just do the same things over and over again. We innovate, and we only know that we innovate because we know what went on before, right? And there's a path to it. So science has a history. Part of a long trend. The growth in scientific knowledge is truly exponential, and it is based on research. Right? What makes it scientific knowledge and not just opinion is that process of research and testing, research and replication, research and criticism that go on in all of this. Published and debated, challenged and verified. We also have some new capacities for knowledge. There are things you can do with computers you couldn't do before computers. There are also things you can do with the ability to travel to South Africa that you couldn't do without airplanes. Right? We have new techniques. I symbolize them with the Hadron Collider, but there are various versions of that. Knowledge has come in particular parts from academic developments, not entirely. The expansion of knowledge institutions includes higher education institutions that house scientific research as well as the teaching of students. But it includes a variety of other structures, different in different countries, and dedicated research centers and institutes that operate outside the university mold, the one that I recently headed, being an example of this, not part of any university, but in conversation with, collaboration with, and support of researchers from many. The SSRC, and indeed the HSRC here, and a variety of analogs around the world do this. They help researchers at different universities collaborate with each other. They make sure that knowledge isn't contained within the local communities, because when it's contained within local communities, it's not being advanced and tested the way that it should be in larger communities. But this now extends to corporate research in new ways. So let the planned building at WITS that is bringing together IBM and creating a new kind of research center in Jinping be a symbol for this. Right. We have the old Oxford University, where I was a student, so I'm sentimental about the attachments to the glorious old buildings and campus-based universities, but lots of science is being done in different institutional contexts today, and we need to be attentive to the changes and what they mean in all of this. We can celebrate the use of knowledge to make and remake the world, because what it means that science has been basic to the world is that the world has been changed by science. We human beings, through science, have made the world. And here I count engineering as science. Personally, don't buy the distinction from pure and applied or engineering's over there somewhere else, long issue in the US. But we make the world. We make the world partly by making technologies that become part of that world. I just mentioned airplanes, for example, and air travel, all that goes into that, and computers, and all that goes into that. But also, if you will, mental technologies. We make the world by changing how we understand the world, for better or worse. And science is a part of this. It is a part of shaping how we understand the global economy, for example. The global economy is not a physical object to observe, but it nonetheless is an object of scientific inquiry. And not only does that scientific inquiry help us understand something that is happening as millions of business people engage in a variety of transactions, it actually involves making some of that. The world of modern finance is a form of financial engineering in which the creation of financial instruments, credit deals, for example, is engineering just as much as the creation of that artificial hand is. And it knits together the world, that world of those credit exchanges that you would understand on the basis of finance, right, is, or in the theories of finance, is part of the connectivity of the whole world just as much as the electrical grid. How is South Africa connected to China, or connected to Europe, or connected to the US? By airplanes, by communications technologies, by finance, right? And finance imposes pressure. You can't just sort of say, I don't like that, so I'm going to ignore it. Or you find yourself facing the kind of crises that, say, Greece faced in 2009 with the international credit agencies saying, or how much did the Rand fall yesterday? Nearly 4%, right? Partly because of, I'm afraid, my president's idiotic policies that have damaged trust in the future of emerging markets around the world. Mm. Right? So far, they haven't hurt the US stock markets very much, though that may come. Right? But what it means is, for South Africa, but for lots of other countries too, you're plugged into a world economy, like it or not. And actions elsewhere are very influential. And the connections, right, have been made in part by science. Science that made weapons, science that made financial instruments, as well as by business and government and other actors in the modern world. We, however, are remaking ourselves in other ways. Think of that hand, right, in the picture, right? A prosthetic device. Prosthetic devices have been revolutionized on the basis of marrying computers to the technology. In recent years, and so there are much better prosthetic devices for people who lose limbs or have other kinds of issues in that. But it goes further. I'll come back and say something more about it. It won't make it a lecture on this in a serious way. But we are literally remaking humanity. Genetic engineering, the use of a variety of nanoscience techniques, right? Partly rethinking what we are, so the omic revolution, biomics, the recognition of all of the microbes that live in us and outside us, changes both the reality of who we are and how we think about humanity. If we think of ourselves as entirely contained within our skin, how do we make sense of the huge amount of genetic material that is contained in organisms that we ingest, right? Or that in some cases pass right through our skin, we are more porous than we have thought of ourselves. We are more hybrid with technology than classic images of the human mind. So when I say science is making and remaking our world, I don't mean just it's remaking things out there. It's remaking us in certain ways. And we better be asking questions about that. We better be asking ethical questions. We better be asking sociological questions, we better be asking economic questions, and we had better be asking technical questions. Like, are there other ways to do this? Because it's not always the case that the first technology that comes around is the best, right? Continued development can be crucial for all of this. And And we better be asking questions about public understanding. It comes first and foremost through education, but not only through education, also through media and so forth. Is the public fully ready to understand the possibility of various choices being made by parents about the genetic makeup of their children on the basis of genetic engineering? Well, you may say, we should pass a law against that. But it will happen elsewhere because there will be medical tourism in which parents with enough money go somewhere where they can get the technique if they do it. And this might be used to eliminate a disease for which there's genetic potential known to be there. But it might also be done for other reasons, say aesthetically, make some children taller. Well, what does it mean if we make some children taller and some children smarter and some children immune from disease on the basis of money? Right? Really changes our conception of the equality of citizens. It changes our conception of human rights. It challenges us. Right? Might be good for each of those kids. Might not. Right? What does it mean that we are de facto experimenting on our children? Right? Do parents own their children? Do parents actually have the right? It turns out legally it seems to be the case in most countries that parents do have the right to make these decisions for their unborn children. But that ought to be a question that we're asking. Right? Should parents be making that choice? Well, should the government be making that choice? That's not necessarily better than having it be made on the basis of money. It might be. Depends on your government. But these are basic issues that we face because science can remake the world. And it's not only the life science remaking of a human individual, it's a variety of other remakings of the world. When we build infrastructure, we reshape society. Right? We determine who lives with good connections and who lives with bad connections. We determine the costs of transport. We change a variety of things in our societies, so forth and so on. Lots of examples you can come up with yourselves. So we celebrate, but we ask questions. I hope we also celebrate the unity of science. I've sort of already said this. But that science, grounded in a common method, which is not just technique, but a method of reasoning, method of learning and testing, right, is common to different knowledge pursuits. There are differences between physicists and biologists, lots of differences. There are differences between either the physicists or the biologists and the humanists, and so forth and so on. But the commonality is strong, and I would stress the unity. The occasion that was alluded to already by Crane of the creation of the International Science Council was a moment for focusing on that unity because it brought together what had been separate, a social science council and a science council for physical and life sciences. The unification is, I think, important because science doesn't have a global voice if it is just the different disciplines and there is not a unity to it. But we also see, I think, more and more ways in which the commitment to learning and to error correction, learning and testing in science, involves people from different disciplines because no one discipline completely controls the technology, its eventual use, and its effects. And even beyond technology, controls the way in which society is remade. That was the celebration. So all the scientific advances we can celebrate. But as I said at the beginning, don't become complacent. Right? I think for the most part, you probably are not complacent. And scientists are increasingly not complacent. But they're not complacent because they've gotten some shocks. There was a lot of tendency to be complacent, to say, wow, it's just amazing. All you have to do is read nature, all you have to do is read science, and you see amazing new things being discovered or being invented every week. That's true. There are really astonishing advances. Don't be complacent, first of all, because unlocking the Prometheus box through all of these inventions means there are a whole lot of things to have to make sense of and to figure out how to make work well for us once they're produced. But also, don't think that every government official in charge of the science budget is reading science and nature every week. Full stop. And if they are, don't think they're appreciating all of it and not looking for the one thing they don't like in it. Right? There is no guarantee that scientific advances translate into continued support for science. And there are shifts in the funding of science, the organization of science, that are enormously important, partly because the costs of science have gone up dramatically. And so the need for large amounts of funding has been increased. And this is not an altogether auspicious moment. So we just talked about, the celebration of this moment of launching an international science council. Great, we're launching this at a moment when science is under threat in many ways. When people are doubted, I actually don't think, all of the leaders believe in science. I'm not going to recount any particular episodes in South Africa's history or in the U.S. history. But I told you I wasn't going to stick my nose in South Africa unduly, right? But this is an issue elsewhere. We live in a troubled world, and it's a troubled world for knowledge. Not just for science in the sense that science is the producers. It's not just they don't fund science as they might. It is that trust in knowledge is deeply challenged in government and in public in various settings. And if there isn't much trust in or faith in knowledge, then the whole point of science, which is to create trusted knowledge, is in jeopardy. So you gotta take this seriously. So it is important to ask whether policymakers are listening. It's important to ask whether the public's listening, because some of them aren't. See, I told you I wouldn't give you a South African example. You can kind of project onto this, right? Donald Trump isn't interested. Right? Donald Trump has systematically gutted knowledge institutions. Donald Trump has never appointed a presidential science advisor. There are no presidential science counselors. There's a commission that is supposed to have a dozen members advising the president. It doesn't have any. He has removed from many of the agencies of the U.S. government scientists. He has installed in some of them, like the Environmental Protection Agency, non-science policy advocates who are advocates for corporate interests, fuel, and have ordered, for example, the scientists of the Environmental Protection Agency basically not to do the work of environmental protection, ordered them not to speak publicly on climate change, for example. Right. So there is a real anti-knowledge campaign, which includes being anti-science, but it's a wider anti-knowledge. It's also the case that the U.S. under Donald Trump has failed to fill many ambassadorships and failed to fill many State Department positions of senior advisors on different parts of the world, because he feels he gets enough knowledge from Fox News. He doesn't need diplomats who really know what's going on. Well, let me not turn this into a political speech about America. I started by saying you've had a little experience of this before here. And I could say that in various ways for different countries around the world. It is an international problem that confidence in basing policy on trustworthy knowledge is low. Even things like census administration. The number of countries that have begun to politicize the census or defund the census, right, rather than having honest numbers about the people in the country, is large. Sadly, the US under Donald Trump is one of them. There's also a certain kind of populist resistance. This is Beppe Grillo, who founded the Five Star Movement in Italy, which just now is in government. I admit that I use his photo not because he's the most influential populist in the world, but because I like the picture. But it kind of gives you this sort of attitude. What? I'm shocked. I didn't know that was true. When you could have known, a lot of things were true, right? A distrust of experts, a distrust of knowledge, right? Of claims to knowledge. Claims to knowledge must be somebody trying to manipulate us, right? Claims to knowledge must be somebody trying to gain at our expense. Claims to knowledge may be creating problems for the slides here. There is a organized range of political movements. Now let me hasten to say, I don't think the populist movements are all wrong. I think they're wrong on science, profession. But I think they're responding to a lack of care for the situation of ordinary people on the part of people who made the world of modern globalization, profited from the world of modern globalization, and didn't worry enough about how it affected their fellow citizens. So I think there is a huge failure on the part of people who used science and technology, including economic technology, in business, to remake the world in a way that worked for them, to make it more unequal. and didn't worry about who benefited very much and didn't provide very much for effective transitions. Because if science is changing the technologies that we live with in all the little ways, from smartphones and the rest of the computer-related technologies through the transportation revolutions that are going on and so forth, this is causing a need for massive adjustment. Hard to get used to this. You only think, you know, we should think of all the grandmothers in the world who are calling their grandchildren and saying, now how do I do that again? I want to get on Facebook, but, right? Or the people who can't even contemplate getting on Facebook because they have no connectivity to the computer system. The people who can't even contemplate the connectivity because they have no electricity, right? So the changes that bring some good things. I like my smartphone, right? When I let it die like I did today and it doesn't work, I feel bad, right? But, right, the fact that it's a good thing doesn't mean that the changes of which it's a part have been beneficial to everybody. And it would take some work and some using of some other sciences, like economics and political science and sociology and anthropology, to try to think through how to do better in absorbing the benefits of the engineering technologies. As one of my favorite scientists would say, there is a problem here, right? Donald Trump, you got Pepe Rio, here's Jürgen Habermas saying, right, essentially, I thought, and I spent my whole illustrious career arguing, that we were doing better on the basis of science and knowledge. That there was an evolutionary process in which, on the basis of argument, on the basis of debate, on the basis of testing our propositions, on the basis of research and evidence, we would be improving the human condition. Habermas still thinks that's the way to do it, but he thinks we haven't done it well enough, and it isn't working, and pretty concerned, right? And asking, as he should, right? How can this go wrong, right? What happened? He's illustrative in an important sense. He was, I think, 13 when World War II ended. His adult life is the recovery from World War II, the effort not to have Nazism happen again, it's like Germany, right? But also a life shaped by the post-war boom years of prosperity and of greater inclusion, the years in which social democracy became more or less the normal approach to political economy in most of Europe. So for 30 years after World War II, there was economic growth, and the economic growth brought more equality. And it brought more social inclusion and more participation. And that changed in the 1970s. And I don't have time to try to go into detail about that story, but it changed since 1975 or so. Inequality has gone up in almost every developed country of the world. To the extent that there has been a reduction in global inequality, it's basically due to China and the extent to which China's been able to lift people out of poverty and travel to China. But inside every OECD country, with one exception, there has been a significant increase in inequality. The exception, by the way, is France, and there's been a small but not huge increase in inequality. Right? So this is not just, right, the rich countries. This is Chile. We're talking, you know, not the very richest countries in the world. We're getting more equal now, have had a significant increase. And the increase is enormous. Right? In the United States, the amount of wealth held by rich people was always greater. Right? But now, right, 2% of rich people hold 90% of the wealth of the country. So it was bad when inequality meant 10 or 20% held 90% of the wealth, but it's worse. These two. And you can measure this in lots of different ways, and you can analyze lots of different things about it, but one of the compelling scientific questions of our age is, what can we do about it? By what means, which are partly political, partly economic, perhaps partly technological, can we change this? So far, we're not, right? Financial crises and other things have not caused us to change this dramatically. We are still on the march of inequality. There is a problem, and it's not just inequality. It is the sense of ordinary citizens that they can be effective in the world or not. So many people feel that it's been taken away from them to be able to be effective. Can they assure their children will have a better life than they had? And the answer is no. Right?
And the answer is no in some rich countries. And for some middle-class people, it's not only no for people in the most difficult situations. That's a challenge. So we have to face the challenges. The challenges include hostility to science. They include a resentment of experts. Who do you think you are to say you know something just because you studied that subject at university? I have an opinion, right? Now that clash is a problem in those terms. If the expert comes across as not valuing the person who doesn't have expertise, they're setting up this distrust of experts. But if everybody else thinks experts are nothing but people who are claiming unfair advantage or unfair pay, that's a problem too, right? Because we need expertise. I've mentioned various technologies, which I do not want to trust to anyone who happens to have an opinion. I don't want surgery from anyone who happens to have an opinion about what will make me feel better. I really want a doctor. Preferably one with good surgical residency. I really don't want the transportation system run by anyone who happens to have an opinion about why there's traffic problems. I really want somebody to analyze this and take it again. Right? There are a whole series of reasons we need experts. We need responsible experts, experts who are committed to the public good, experts who are honest, but we do need experts. And if we have so allowed the respect for experts to be eroded, we better start rebuilding it, right? Because that's part of this wider contempt for knowledge. And part of this is that we have been poor public educators. The public doesn't understand us very well. We complain about that all the time, but we kind of act as though it's the public's problem. It's our problem, right? The people who shape regulations are our undergraduates. The people who will shape regulations in 10 years and determine how genetic engineering works in society are our undergraduates now, and we had better be doing a good job of scientific education. And therefore, there had better be adequate public investment to make that effective education possible, and the effective education better includes some serious science. It's not enough to say we're going to do entry-level access for the entire population and abandon research and research universities. What we have to do is find good connections between high-level science, serious scientific teaching, and the larger system. And that's a challenge. Hostility to science and experts is all over the place. I already alluded to it. And just, Britain's had enough of experts, said the Minister of Education, right, immediately before Brexit. Right? There's the media issues that go with this. We could emphasize Russian hacking, or we could emphasize various different versions of this, but the ability of people to suspend disbelief is large, and the willingness of various media organizations, most of them for-profit, some of them maliciously political, to try to manipulate beliefs. The number, I thought, oh, well, I'll look for one of the scurrilous stories about Hillary. I actually had missed that she adopted an alien baby. Right? I expected that there would be stories about how she was running a child prostitution ring out of the basement of a pizza parlor in Washington, and there were, right? But yeah. There are page after page after page after page of different examples of this, false, generally speaking, right? But somebody is buying these papers or they wouldn't be profitable, right? What's happening? And one of the things about truth, alas, is when you begin to put it on a sliding scale, you're in trouble, right? When you say, oh, I know that's not true, but all those other things are true, right? When you begin to say, we should discount this, it's probably only half true. It's not half true, it's completely false, right? But this is a problem, the tendency that we often have to imagine a sort of charitable fairness in this. And part of our problem is a media problem in the sense of proliferating sources. There's not an effective authoritative news media, there's not an effective authoritative science media that gets information out to people in ways which they can say, oh, this is what I should believe. That's a silly story. Right? And so maybe almost nobody believes Hillary adopted an alien baby. The fact I have to say almost nobody worries me. Right? But there are a variety of things people do believe. Absolutely contrary to serious, well-researched, well-tested scientific knowledge. Others. The manipulation of data may be equally concerning, right? Data drives all we do, well, a lot of that.
This is an ad from Cambridge Analytica. Mm-hmm. You may have heard of Cambridge Analytica. This is the firm that Donald Trump hired in his campaign to help lead a media disinformation campaign. Mm-hmm. Yeah, data drives all we do. Who drives the data? How is it used? How is this organized? Right, Facebook and Twitter and others have been announcing in a series of different press releases in recent weeks how many fake accounts they've been eliminating and how much they've been trying to do to minimize this. And this is a glass half full, half empty situation. So you can say, well, good, I'm glad they're eliminating those accounts. How did those accounts all get to be there? Because the numbers are enormous of the extent to which social media is full of this. And this doesn't just create some new story, right? It shapes what people see because of the algorithms that are driving this and the way in which they control attention, right? So that what's going on with this is, what do you see first when you turn on your computer? Do you see first what a well-meaning editor of a newspaper decided was most important? Do you see first something that's been manipulated by a whole variety of fake Twitter accounts clicking, I like this, right? When they don't really exist and a robot is behind them, right? So there's a huge thing, right? And we can really go on about campaigners, right? Barack Obama's view that Donald Trump's view that Barack Obama's birth certificate is a fraud, which he's actually brought up again recently. It's not something he just said 10 years ago, right? In which his technique is to sow doubt. Well, I don't know for sure. Do you know for sure? You say, well, I haven't seen Barack Obama's birth certificate, right? You begin to doubt, right? It's the sowing of doubt. But here's research published in Science in March, right? Falsehood diffuses faster than truth, right? True statements do not spread in the media as fast as false statements,
yeah.
Right? So there is a catch-up game, and we are in a bit of trouble here in science. Some of this has to do with outright lies, with fraud, some with deceptively overstated results, right? Picture on the top of the snow, guy out walking with a shovel, right? It's taken on a sunny day. There was no snow. It's been photoshopped. It's been altered, right? There are versions of it that show a rainy day, the virtual evidence, right? So seeing is believing is a problem when you're seeing things that have been that altered in that. Or take the picture on the bottom, which is a Silicon Valley company, some of you may have heard of Theranos, that promised blood tests for a variety of things, and cheap and easy blood tests, which would be a good thing. It would be a great thing to have cheap and easy blood tests, right? Was a darling of investors, and literally billions, $5 billion, were invested in Theranos to build this. Before it was shown that the company was systematically falsifying its results, it's just been dissolved. It was 3 days ago, the company was dissolved. It doesn't exist. They returned the remaining money to some of the creditors. But they didn't make up for the damaged trust in science, right? That this woman from Stanford University who had that perfectly good idea but was willing to engage in fraud to promote the idea, right, has challenged all of us who may have very good and useful medical technologies or very good and useful investment opportunities by the fact that for several years, she was able to continue to get investments. And these guys who are giving her hundreds of thousands and millions of dollars are not stupid. They are not even the man in the street when it comes to their ability to access knowledge. They have a lot of information, and yet the fraud is perpetuated. So the world of science and technology, right, is part of the problem. And it's part of the problem in general if we cheat, but we cheat a lot more, it turns out, when we're driven by profit motives and by intense competition and by investment cycles in which you have to have a lot of hype up front to get the resources to continue developing your new technology. So there is an organized system that is producing some of the fraud and some of the deceptions, right? Hype is a big issue, right? The substitution of a TED Talk. I saw his TED Talk, he was brilliant, he was charismatic, he really would have gripped me for 5 minutes. That is not a refereed article. Right? That might be true, that might not be true. Right? Nothing wrong with these short presentations that circulate on the web. They can be good. The point is, we collectively, the public and the policymakers especially, aren't following that up with some tests, some truth checking often enough. Truth checking doesn't get nearly the
just lies again. Right? And so there are a variety of problems. And one of the reasons the public has the level of distrust in experts that it has is that every day you can see on TV or in the newspaper experts declaring various completely contradictory fragments of things, some of which may be true, right? But there's, you know, if you work with this diet, you will lose weight. If you work with this diet, you will die. If you, you know, and the number of things and the tension between them, right? Should you drink coffee?
Yeah.
Yes, of course, because caffeine is helpful against Parkinson's disease, right? Are there 10 other medical conditions that excessive coffee drinking aggravates? Yes. How do you decide, right? Or wine drinker, alcohol in general? A new study has just come out with much more damning influence on alcohol. I'm very disappointed in that, because I'm short of a particular form, the so-called good cholesterol, that would be enhanced by drinking. So my doctor had told me I could drink, and I thought this was great until this new study came out. Right? Well, all of us are getting all this contradictory information all the time. That's a challenge, even a challenge for your local physician, right? As well as for ordinary patients. And science is not automatically good. We build bombs, we build missiles, right? We build highly unequal societies on the basis of science. We have to be thinking about this. We are building a world choking in waste, and we better be thinking about that. This is not high tech, but this is influenced by the tech industry. Plastic had to be invented. It was part of making and remaking the modern world that I talked about to create all of these non-biodegradable plastic products that are clogging the oceans and making the beaches less attractive and causing inland water supplies to be choked. This is a problem, right? Now, what do we do? Well, we actually can do the science. Science on climate change was done relatively quickly, relatively effectively. It didn't have the public impact it should have had as early as it should. It wasn't disseminated. It didn't make the policy, right? The problem isn't with the science, right? There's enormous consensus in the scientific community. The problem is that people were able to sow doubt about that consensus, like Donald Trump sowing doubt about Barack Obama's birth certificate. Well, you know, 99.9% of scientists agree, but, you know, we should take seriously that other 0.1%. And, by the way, they're funded by the fossil fuel industry, but that doesn't really matter because we have to give everybody an equal voice. And, in fact, in the United States, the Supreme Court has decided that it's a right of free speech for the fossil fuel industry to do this, that the corporations have the same rights of citizenship and free speech that individual human beings have. Which is an interesting remaking of the human individual that I talked about. Right? The global economy is getting restructured. Right? Our inability to deal with climate change is partly due to that. We aren't willing to make the economic sacrifices it would take to deal with it. So maybe we're all going to be toast. No, it'll only be our grandchildren who are toast. It's okay. We can collaborate to do better. Climate change is not the worst story. We didn't do enough fast enough, so it's a pretty dire future. But actually, the world of science did collaborate pretty effectively. The oceanographers, the atmospheric scientists, the economists actually got together pretty much on climate change eventually. It's a story of relative success that failed to have the policy impacts it should. Right? But think of all of these others. Artificial intelligence, that I mentioned before. We need not just brilliant AI researchers developing the new technology, we need collaborations with a variety of others. And in fact, I'm thinking of social scientists, ethicists, and people like that, but I can think of other scientists. Because the deployment of AI is changing science everywhere. It is changing the platforms for scientific research in almost every field. So in any field of wet science, of bench science, there are ways in which AI capacity to do different sorts of research is beginning to have an impact and different sorts of application. So gene editing, which I referred to earlier, which is the second thing, is fusing with AI, right? The ability to do this kind of work depends on the ability to use AI tools, as well as other kind of laboratory tools, to do the genetic engineering. So thinking within the traditional categories is a problem. Neuroscience is a field that, you know, there's neuroeconomics now. There are a variety of ways in which neuroscience has begun to influence other fields through collaboration, because we have deeply different understandings of the brain. Neuroscience influences AI, because the hottest thing in AI technology is neural network formations in which the effort started as one, a
of trying to maximize networks mathematically, and then people start saying, we ought to ask how the brain works, because the brain does a pretty amazing job, and now computers that imitate the brain, right, have taken off, and it turns out that the brain does things like have certain amounts of redundancy, have the ability to forget, have other things that affect its processing, make it effective, that can be modeled into computers. And we could go on and on with this in modern science. We need to address data challenges, and we need to collaborate to do it. It can't be some other specialty that deals with privacy issues, security issues, access issues, bias issues. It affects all of our work with data. Everybody who works with data needs to be thinking about this. And social science is fully a part of all of this. But collaborating can also address global inequality and is constrained by global inequality. So this is a representation of the number of scientific researchers per million people in different parts of the world. The darker the color, the more researchers there are per million people. You can hardly see Africa, right? You can see, you know, a little bit. And South Africa is slightly better shaded. Latin America doesn't look great. Well, Asia is pretty uneven, right? There is an enormous skewing of where the scientific research is being done. This affects who can benefit from it, and it affects what scientific research is to be done. And here, or in any other country, being able to be a protagonist in science, being able to be part of the creative process of new knowledge, is part of being able to be an effective country in the modern world. It's not just an optional extra, right? It's part of being able to be an effective country. In order to deal with the big global changes that are going on, we need scientific collaboration. I won't belabor all the points, but think of all the issues, say, of cybersecurity, of security in general in the world, and imagine being able to confront them without that. Collaborate for all the basic reasons that we do science in the first place, to nurture stronger knowledge, to integrate fragmented knowledge into a better whole picture, build global networks, to inform the public, to inform policymakers. We need to collaborate. Collaborating sounds great, and I think everybody is in favor of it. We still only do it much less than we should. And Robert Merton, a great sociologist of science, historian of science, had something to say about that. Scientific research is public, not private knowledge, in a basic way. He even talked about a communism of science, that science was essentially communistic. What did he mean? He meant it only works when it's shared. If you find things out and you keep that to yourself, you ruin the scientific process, right? Not just do people not get the benefit of it, there's no way to test it, right? So publication is a basic part of science. Testing is a basic part of science. And making science public is. So this links back to Ismail Saragudin's talk on open source, which is one of the dimensions of how science gets to be public. But there are a lot of these. How does scientific advice to the government work? Is there also scientific advice to trade unions, to social movements, to other actors besides the government? Right? Science needs to be public knowledge. But one of the biggest issues for science, linking back to the data issue, is proprietary data and scientific findings that are not disclosed. The SSRC, which Crane kindly mentioned I used to head, has just concluded an agreement with Facebook and a variety of others to act as a trusted source in enabling researchers to use Facebook data. It's a good thing, right? All Facebook data? No, some Facebook data. This is an advance over none of it being made publicly available, but it's not all the way to all of it being made publicly available. Facebook employs something like 2,000 PhD social scientists and data scientists to devise algorithms to shape people's attention. That mean doing experimental research to figure out what can get and hold your attention, psychological work, social psychology, coupling this with the development of algorithms and AI to be able to manipulate this online to govern what you pay attention to, right? And most of that research is proprietarial and not openly available to the public. And it's not just Facebook. There's no story about Facebook being bad. This is the dominant story of corporate research. It's increasingly proprietarial. So crucial research in the life sciences, in the physical sciences, in engineering, in social sciences, is organized and conducted in ways where it doesn't become public. Now, as it happens, we need
those corporations to care about knowledge. It is not to our benefit if they stop caring about knowledge. We need them to fund scientific research. It is not to our benefit if they don't. But we need to find ways, as much as possible, to enhance public access to scientific knowledge. And for a start, without that access, we won't have the collaboration we need among the scientists. We have some issues. But we have some great science. Let's put these together. Thank you.